Well, good morning. Good to be here again today, and we have rain, which is a blessing. I'm partially convinced it's because we have a guest from Canada, and we have abundance of rain in Canada. But this morning, we're blessed to have Pastor Brent Cantelon from Vancouver, Canada, and he has been a pastor for over 30 years, 35 years in Canada, and has a heart and a passion for the growth of the church, the maturity of the believers, and now is spending his full time as an evangelist, traveling throughout Canada as well as throughout the world, and bringing the gospel of Jesus as well as discipleship within the church. And he was on his way from Addis back to Canada, and so we want to thank you for taking the time and coming, and let's welcome Pastor Brent Cantelon.
Wonderful to be here with you, everyone. God bless you. I want to thank your pastors, Gerald and Pat, and the council, everyone who is so gracious. You take a risk every time you have a guest. I know that. But we are friends from a long time, really getting acquainted on this trip. So thank you so much. It is my first time to the Middle East. And I'm enjoying the experience so much. I am blessed to travel all over the world. And so I love peoples from all lands and all cultures. I love the different food. And so I've been hosted so well here. I was down in the souk and I had Kuwaiti food and the tea, the coffee ceremony. And it was a beautiful thing. I just loved it. The message that I want to bring this morning, I'll get to it in a moment, but I just want to testify. I know that you are global citizens, you come from all over the world, but I want to testify that God is at work all over the planet. He's at work in every nation. We may not see it always, you know, CNN and the BBC aren't going to cover it. But God is at work, and heaven is keeping the records, and we thank God for that. I am so blessed. I married my high school sweetheart. We met when she was 12 and I was 14. We grew up, my father was a pastor, we grew up in the youth group together, and I thought she was a little young for me at 12, being 14, so I had to give her some time to grow up, but... We were married in our early 20s. We have four children, two boys, two girls. They're all married. All four of them serve in ministry to the glory of God. And I know you will find this hard to believe, but we have 9 grandchildren and 2 more on the way. And so we're just so thankful to the Lord. I don't know, you've met the Goldbecks, and some of you have been to Canada. I don't know how much you know about us Canadians, but we are a strange people. I love the different languages and the different cultures. Every culture is so different. And one of the things you need to know about Canadians, we're known as a very polite people, and the word that we are the most famous for now in the world is the word sorry. Canadians are known all over the planet. I go to people, I was in China recently, and a sweet Chinese brother came up to me. He said, "Oh, Canada, sorry." I don't know how he knew, but Canadians are the only people on the planet, two people come to the same door, they both open the door and stand back and say, "Sorry, sorry," they wait for one another. I don't think it's like that in other cultures. I was in Bangladesh not long ago in the queue for the customs lineup, and I don't know how it happened. I began at the start of the line, and in a few minutes, I was at the back of the line. And so I would move to a different line where I was closer to the front. And in a few minutes, I would be at the back of that line. We just don't know how to queue up in Canada, where I was going, "Oh, go ahead, sure, fine, yeah." We Canadians tend to apologize for everything. I don't know what it is about us, but other countries, they don't apologize quite the same. And I've been to India many times. I see many beautiful Indian people here. Your food is my favorite in the world, I'll just tell you. When my wife and I go on a date, we go for Indian food, and we like it hot and spicy. So, but in India, my first time, I was taking a taxi, an auto rickshaw, one of those little three-wheeled ones. And I wasn't familiar with the custom, and I gave the man the address. I said, "Do you know where this is?" And he said, "Yes." I said, "No, do you know where it is?" And he just gave me the head bob. I can't even do it, you know. But there, that means maybe I know, maybe I don't, but I'm not going to tell you. I want you to come with me and I'll take your money, you know. I was in a Canadian church. Now, I'm going to, evangelists, we have a privilege. We can exaggerate just a little bit. Is that okay? Just a little exaggeration, yeah. I was at a Canadian church and they were announcing a prayer meeting. Now, the other thing about Canadians is we have an accent. Have you noticed? I have an accent. Canadians don't think they do. I say to Canadian churches, "Do you know you have an accent?" They all look at each other. "No, we don't have an accent." We have this hard R. We say, "Jesus is Lord." We land on the R. We say, "We are the church of the living God." That's Canadian accent. In Africa, they have a different way of saying, they say, "We are the church." Canadians, we are the church. In Africa, "We are the church." We say, "Of the living God, of the living God." You see? It's the same words. I think I got some Nigerians here somewhere there. The same words, but they sound so different, you know? So I was in this Canadian church, and they were announcing a prayer meeting. And the pastor was apologizing for announcing a prayer meeting. Now, it's like, "Now we're having a prayer meeting Saturday evening at 7 p.m. I know you are so busy, and you have activities, and it's a busy time. We'll only pray from 7 till 8 o'clock. And we apologize for this prayer meeting." You know, that's the exaggeration. That's Canadian. But it went on and on. And I thought, well, I feel so bad about this prayer meeting. I don't think I'll even go. And so that's the Canadian way. In East Africa, if they were announcing that same prayer meeting, it would be quite different. It would be "We are having a prayer meeting and you will be there. We will pray from 7 until the fire falls. And we will change the nation with passion and vision. And the church of the living God will say, So, I want to go to that prayer meeting, don't you? I think the Canadians are apologizing to God. "Lord, we're sorry to bother you. We know you're busy." The Africans are storming heaven until the answer comes. So we're all so different, but we all have the love of Jesus in our hearts. Amen. We've experienced the forgiveness of the blood of the Lamb. We're part of the body of Christ. And so no matter what nation we come from, what language we speak, when we're in Christ, we are the body of Jesus Christ. And it's a beautiful thing. Hallelujah. So I want you to believe with me that God has great things further than what you have known and experienced already here in Kuwait. One of the things that started happening to me as I traveled, it first happened to me in Russia. I was picked up at the airport by my host, and he began to tell me how difficult it is to minister in Russia. He began to talk to me about the various political movements and the various religious movements, and he was preparing me for the meetings that I shouldn't expect much. He's saying, "This is a difficult place, this place." And he was going on about how hard it was for the work of God. So that was the first time I had it happen. The second time I had it happen was in my country, in the French-speaking province of Quebec. And the pastor picked me up at the airport and began to tell me, "You know, this is a very hard place to minister. We have the most secular society in North America, in Quebec. People are leaving the churches. There's disunity among the churches. Pastor, thank you for coming, but this is a hard place. Don't expect much here. And it was the second time. And then it began to happen to me in country after country. I went to a small village in Zambia, and they said, you know, this is a hard place for the gospel. The people here, they are so poor. The people here, they have no education. We've not had rain. The people are in drought. They're close to starvation. This is a difficult place to build the church of God. And then in my country, in the city that I come from, it's called Vancouver, people started saying to me, you know, Vancouver, Canada, is a hard place. Now listen carefully. They said, the people here have so much money. The people here have so much education. The people here have such natural beauty. They can go to the mountains and the ocean, and it's a hard place to build the church. And the pattern started to show up. A country like India that says, this is a hard place. We have 2 million gods. The people are confused. And then I go to a country like Canada and they say, atheism is growing in our nation. People don't even believe in God. It's a hard place. It's a hard place when the people are poor. It's a hard place when the people are rich. Maybe you've said that about your country or about this country. But I began to think, Lord, what is this pattern? And it just seemed like the Lord was emphasizing this word to me. I've never had a pastor pick me up at the airport and say, oh, pastor, this is an easy place for the gospel. You will love it here. It's easy, the gospel. Never. It's always, it's hard here. It's difficult here. So I thought, well, maybe it was easy in the New Testament. Maybe the gospel ran freely in the Bible. And there were no troubles. And I love the book of Acts, you know, and I tend to land on the high points. On the day of Pentecost, there were 3,000 saved. Oh, what a wonderful story. I thought maybe it was easy for the disciples. You know, they were with Jesus. The first time we meet the disciples after the resurrection, they're huddled in a room for fear of those who had crucified Christ. They're afraid. Every time something started to happen, I thought, well, surely the ministry of Jesus must have been easy. I mean, he was the Son of God. He performed miracles. We're told in Matthew chapter 11 that says Jesus began to rebuke the cities in which most of his mighty works had been done because they did not repent. The Son of God. He speaks about the cities of Chorazin and Bethsaida. It says they other cities would have repented, but you wouldn't. So even the Son of God performing miracles, there was still entire cities that did not repent. Maybe after Pentecost. I don't know if you've read the New Testament and thought, my, it must have been wonderful, so close to when Jesus walked and the upper room and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and they were all filled and 3,000 got saved. But those are the same people that shortly after that began to be persecuted and they had to flee for their lives. Those are the same people who would be persecuted to death for their faith in Christ. What about the Apostle Paul? Surely it was easy for him. We know he had this miraculous experience on the Damascus Road. He had a revelation of Jesus. Well, what about Paul? Well, in Acts, we find chapter 9, the first place that he preached was Damascus. And he caused so much trouble that the disciples had to let him down the wall in a basket. He was the original basket case. He had to flee for his life after his first sermons. What about in Antioch? That's the wonderful place where the church was first called Christians. And we read in the book of Acts about Antioch. There was a good response. But it was Antioch where we have the famous verse that says they shook the dust off of their feet as they were pushed out of the city. How about Ephesus? Ephesus, the great church pastored by Timothy. Acts chapter 19, such a wonderful story. It says all the believers were filled with the Holy Spirit. If you look carefully, there were 12 believers who were filled with the Holy Spirit. After 3 months, the ministry was going well, and it says some were hardened and opposed. After 2 years, things were going well. There were healings. That's the place where they would pray for a handkerchief and take it to someone and they'd be healed. But then we read that there was someone who rose up. His name was Demetrius. And the entire city ends up in an uproar in the theater, shouting, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." And again, the apostles had to run. So it wasn't easy in the New Testament, brothers and sisters. It wasn't without opposition. It wasn't without persecution or trouble or conflict. So are there hard places in the world? Yes, there are. In fact, every place is challenging, and every place is a hard place. Some people have more hard people. Some places have more hard people than others. But every place at the same time has many seeking people. Every place has many people who are searching for God, who are hungry for truth, and who are dealing with confusion and frustration and questions. Jesus said in John chapter 16, "I've told you these things so that you will have peace in me. Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world." Jesus said, this is what's going to happen. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. If they reject the message from me, they'll reject it from you. But take heart, I have overcome the world. That he is our conqueror. He is our one who goes before in victory. And Jesus taught us in Mark chapter 4 that the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground and should sleep by night and rise by day. And the seed should sprout and grow, and he himself does not know how. The gospel is likened to seed all throughout the New Testament, particularly the teachings of Jesus. A seed that is planted. And when the rains come, that seed germinates and starts to grow, and we don't know how. It's a miracle. There is life inherent in the seed. And brothers and sisters, there is inherent supernatural life in the seed of the gospel. And if the gospel, like a seed, is spread, it will begin to germinate and begin to bear fruit. We don't know how, we don't know when, but wherever the gospel goes, and I can testify, there is going to be fruit. There is going to be a response in the spiritual realms. And yes, there will be accompanying opposition. And yes, everyone does not come to faith in Christ. But the heart of God is reaching out to those who are searching. Jesus tells us in Luke chapter 8 about the four types of soil. We know there will be hard soil. We know there will be rocky and thorny soil. But in the midst of every hard soil, thorny soil, and rocky soil place, there is good soil. Jesus said so, brothers and sisters. I'm not making this up. Jesus said, there is good soil. The heart of God is for every person. Jesus tells us over and over in the parables that the heart of God is for the one who is lost, the sheep, the coin that is lost, the prodigal who is lost. In the parable of the banquet, Jesus tells the servant to go out and to bring in those from the lanes and the highways and the hedges. Every soul is precious to God, be it children, be it those who are the poorest or those who are the wealthiest. Every soul is precious to God. And every soul created in the image of God is valuable to God. The Bible teaches there's no difference in gender, in status, that a soul is a soul is a soul. And Jesus died for every single one of them. I heard recently of a billionaire in Hong Kong who came to faith in a boardroom through the Alpha Course, known as one of the wealthiest men in Hong Kong. The gospel brought life and liberty to him. I have friends where I come from who lived hopeless lives as alcoholics on the streets of Vancouver begging for money, drunk. And those people have come to faith in Jesus and love him and have been transformed by his power. Children who come to faith in Jesus. I was privileged one time to visit a man in the hospital who was unconscious. He wasn't a believer. His family said, "Will you go and visit him?" And I said, "Yes, I'll go." And the man was unconscious. And it's always been my practice. We've heard testimonies of people who've been in a coma who come out who say, "I could hear what was happening." So I said to the family, "Can I pray with him?" They said, "Yes, please." So I leaned down close to his ear and I just began to talk to him about Jesus. And I said, "It could be that you're not going to be in this world very long. I'd like to lead you in a prayer to receive Jesus so that you would go to heaven." He didn't respond. He didn't move. I began to pray. And as I prayed, a tear started to roll down his cheek as the Spirit of God touched his heart. I believe that man went to be with Jesus later that day. A soul is a soul is a soul. And as you look at this amazing city that you're privileged to live in, how do you see the people that are all around you, the people in expensive cars, the people sweeping the streets? How do you see them? Do you see them as God sees them? Or do we think, "Oh, this is a hard place. We can't reach them." As I said, we have four kids. And we're so thankful for our children. They're the joy of our lives. And my youngest son is named Samuel. My next daughter is Rachel. My next daughter is Laura. And my oldest son is Benjamin. When the children were all home and they were young, we went to a big shopping mall. It's famous in Canada, called the West Edmonton Mall. And my youngest son, Samuel, had developed a thing. He liked to run. He was maybe about 5 years old. We had got him some new shoes, and he thought that those shoes made him run fast because they were running shoes, right? So you run in your running shoes. So I'd say to him, "Samuel, will you run for me?" And he would do this. He would put his leg up, and he would make a sound. And he would run. I think it was on television. He'd seen a cartoon. You know, when they run, they go, and then dust comes up behind them as they take off. It was just like pushing a button. I'd say, "Samuel, can you run for me?" And off he would go. So we're in the shopping center. We're looking at clothes. And maybe you've had this happen. I was distracted. And I don't know whether one of the kids told him to run. I don't know what happened. But I turned around and Samuel was gone. It's a huge mall, multi-floors, hundreds of people. We began to call, "Samuel, Samuel!" And he didn't answer. "Speak, Lord, your servant heareth." There was no answer. I mean, it was silent. We began to run into the stores. "Have you seen our boy, Samuel? He's about this high. My wife is crying. We're running." I went to the security guard. I said, "My son is lost. Can you make an announcement? We're missing our son." And it was a terrible, it seemed like forever. You think, "I'm a terrible parent. I've lost one of my children. How does that even happen?" You know, and so after a while, I see the security guard is coming. He has my son holding his hand, and Sam's smiling and happy, and we were just so relieved. Our son was back. I did take him around the corner behind a post and say, "If you ever do that again, then we came back out smiling, and... What kind of a father would I be? What kind of a dad? What kind of heart would I have? What would you think of me if I went to the security guard and I said, "Excuse me, sir, we're missing one of our children. His name is Samuel, and we would really like to find him. But I know you are so busy. I know you have a lot of things that you're concerned with. And it may be that you don't have time. And if that's the case, I understand. It's okay, because I have three other good children." You know, what if I lose one? Like, I've just lost 25% of my family. I still have 75%. My percentage is still very good. So don't trouble yourself. If we don't find him, don't worry. Well, you would think I was crazy, right? You think these Canadians have lost their minds. No, I want all four of my children to be with me. Don't you want all of your children with you? We don't say, oh, if I lose one, it doesn't matter. Oh, if I have 75%, that's pretty good. As God looks at your city, he sees every son, every daughter, every breathing soul as his own, as loved, as who Christ shed his blood for. There isn't one breathing human in this great nation that God doesn't love and care for, and that God doesn't long to see come into his purpose and his power and his fellowship. His heart is for everyone. His heart is for every person, every nationality, every tribe. So brothers and sisters, what is our response? Is our response to excuse ourselves and say, well, this is a hard place. You're a guest. You don't understand. It's difficult here to be fruitful. And I don't disagree with you because there are challenges here. I've heard. But I want to tell you that there are challenges in every nation of the world. I've just come from Ethiopia, and they have massive challenges, and yet the gospel's going forward. I've ministered in China a number of times, still a communist nation. Massive challenges. It's difficult, but the church is growing by thousands and hundreds of thousands. The gospel is able. There is a way, brothers and sisters. If we're willing to trust the Holy Spirit, he will make a way where it seems difficult. The children of Israel came up to the sea, and God made a way through it. There was no food. He made a way. It's what our God does. It's who he is. He specializes in showing his glory when we think it's impossible. God is glorified in that situation. Praise the Lord. So how will we respond? First thing, I want to challenge you. Instead of speaking negatively, instead of speaking death, instead of speaking how difficult it is and giving glory to the enemy, I want to challenge you, church, to rise up with faith and let your action and your words speak of the power of God, not the power of the enemy. And instead of saying, this is a hard place, I want to challenge you to begin to make your first response, this is a blessed place in Jesus' name. This is a place loved by God. This is a place chosen, and the Lord will give it to us. This is an open place. This is a place that God has promised to bless. The people are not harder here than other places in the world. Begin to speak in faith. There are open people here. There are searching, hurting, questioning people here. It's not more difficult here. The Holy Spirit is not weaker here than in other places of the world. He is the same in every place. The Holy Spirit has not left your neighborhood or left your city. And the gospel transforms the same in every place. Could you begin in your heart to say, this is a blessed place. This is a place in the favor of God. This is a place that is pregnant with expectation. And there is a harvest that can be 100 times the seed sown in this place. Brothers and sisters, this isn't just tricky talking. This isn't tricky think. It's not mind over matter. The Bible tells us this is true. The Bible says that his heart is for this place. I have a friend in Zambia who taught me this. He said, you can measure the seed, but you can never measure the harvest. You can measure the faithfulness of your witness or your love or your invitation, but God is the one who gives the harvest. So first of all, let's begin to believe and speak. This is a blessed place. Let's anticipate. We have 2 of our daughters-in-law right now who are expecting a baby. We are expecting the birth of those babies. One of them's a little girl. I can't believe it. Another little granddaughter. I'm so excited to meet her. I'm expecting. That's why they say when a woman is pregnant, she's expecting. Expecting a birth. Expecting another child. Let's be those who say, this is a blessed place. We're expecting. We're believing God has more. The second thing is that our God delights to show his power when things seem impossible. Our God has been doing this all through the scripture, all through church history. And when we get to the end of the book, even Satan is overcome by the power of God. Revelation 12 says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 7 says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power of God may be shown. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are troubled, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. The Apostle Paul said it this way, none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify of the gospel of the grace of God. When the situation looks impossible, brothers and sisters, our God rises up to show his power. And he is glorified. He is glorified. The third thing to remember today is that the good news message of Jesus Christ has miraculous power. The gospel has power to heal the sick, to deliver those who are in demonic captivity. The gospel has power to bring light to the darkness. Salvation is a miracle. It's not a natural thing. Forgiveness is a miracle. Eternal life is a miracle. I was so blessed to be hosted by a young couple in the church, Ahmed and Heba, and they were telling me their story of coming to faith in Jesus. It's a miracle. Everyone who comes to Jesus is a miracle. So never put aside the power of a word of testimony and think that nothing will happen. It's a miracle. And when you are obedient, you partner with the Holy Spirit. In the country I just came from, we met with a number of people from the ancient church of that country. A number of years ago, one of the men who now is sharing Christ and thousands of people are coming to faith, he was crossing the street. He had robes on. He looked very holy, very religious. As he was crossing the street, someone in a car, he doesn't know who, rolled down their window and passed him a copy of the Bible. He had never seen a Bible before. He was forbidden. He took that Bible and he began to read it. And God spoke to his heart. He fell to his knees. He repented of his sin. It was a miracle. It was the power of the Word of God, the power of the gospel in his life. I don't propose to tell you how to serve God in your nation. I'm so new here, I don't know what you can do, what you can't do, what is right, what is wrong. I don't know, but the Holy Spirit knows. And the Bible says that the Holy Spirit will teach you how to operate where you live. He'll teach you. He'll show you. And the gospel is a miracle, a simple word. And you may think it's just a meaningless word, but the Holy Spirit, when you partner with the Holy Spirit, he can take that word and make it sink into the heart of the good soil. In our church in Langley, we have a brother. He's a ministry. He's like Barnabas. He's an encourager. Every time you talk to him, he encourages you. I like those kinds of people, don't you? I prefer them to those who are the other way, the discouragers. Oh, everything is terrible. Everything is awful. Everything is terrible. The price of oil is going further down. Everything is awful. You know, you've met those guys, right? But this guy is the opposite of that. He was an encourager. In fact, he was a little bit scary. He was such an encourager. He would answer the telephone like this. Terrific, good morning. And you'd kind of be... So he's a little over the top, but he had a great ministry of encouragement. One day, in the men's washroom, we had a big, long counter and big mirror, and he was in there, and there was another man down, a couple of sinks down, and he was just combing his hair, quiet. There was no interaction. My friend looked at that man and said, "Hey, you're looking good today, my friend." And he walked out. That was it. He walked out. That was it. The guy didn't answer, didn't say anything, just looked at him. We found out later that that man had come to church that day, and it was to be the very last thing he did before he killed himself. He said, "The last thing I'll do is go to church, and then I will die." And when my friend spoke to him, he looked in the mirror and he thought, "Yeah, I look pretty good today." And the Holy Spirit witnessed in his heart and he thought, "I'm going to live and not die." We hold back so often when perhaps just a look into somebody's eye, just say, "Hey, you're looking good today." That man lived because of this other man's obedience. The Holy Spirit will be your partner, and God will help you because the gospel is a miracle. So, brothers and sisters, my challenge to you today is, in faith, begin to declare as you walk, as you work, as you drive, begin to declare in this city, this is a blessed place. Begin to declare when you see the pictures of your honored leader that God would bless them and that God would bless this nation. Let the Christians of this nation be known as those who bless the nation, as those who honor the nation with the love of God. This is a blessed place. And if you are facing an impossible situation, know that God is just waiting to show his glory in your impossible situation. He delights in situations where there seems to be no way. He is the God. Come on, he is the God who makes a way where there is no way. That's who we serve. Not just a dead religion, not just an idol with no voice, but the living God who makes a way. And thirdly, the gospel is a miracle. I challenge you, brothers and sisters, let the miracle power of Jesus flow through your life. You be led as the Spirit leads you. You be sensitive to the culture. You know the ways. I don't. But let me encourage you to let the gospel flow through you as the Spirit leads you. Because I know, because Jesus said, there's good soil in this city. Amen. There's good soil just waiting. You might meet somebody who's in a crisis. Love them. You might meet someone who's in a transition from another country. There are hundreds, thousands in your nation. Transition is difficult. Love them. Be their friend. You might find somebody who's in a terrible time of sickness or family crisis. Love them. And let the miracle power of the Holy Spirit flow through your life. Let's pray together this morning. Could you bow your heads? Close your eyes. Lord God, I thank you that this is a blessed place. Because you are here. You love this land. You love these people. You have appointed this place to be a gathering point of the nations of the world. Lord, let the nations that come be a blessed people who bless this land, Lord. We pray that you will make a way for those people in the room this morning who feel that it's impossible, that they're facing a struggle or a crisis themselves and it's impossible. Encourage them right now, Lord. You've not forgotten who they are. You can make a way in their situation. And then, Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit, I pray. That we would be able to release the miracle power of the gospel in this amazing land, that you will be glorified. Encourage the leaders of this church, I pray. Encourage all who serve. Encourage the pastors, Lord. And we pray for many, many, many who will come to faith in Christ with joy. Lord, we ask for a revival in the land of Kuwait. We ask, oh God, that you will break through and that what seems to be impossible will be said that it was made possible by your power in Jesus' name. Give us faith for that, oh God. Give us faith to look forward in Jesus' name. That the best days are in front of us, God. That you have called us to faith, to live in your blessing. So, Father, we thank you for this. We thank you for your word today. We pray, be glorified. Be glorified in Lighthouse Church. Be glorified in every person's life and influence in this great city. And we pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you.